Hey guys, it's Jeff Lafferty, episode number 91. Should be 92, but I flaked out on you guys and didn't get my video up yesterday. Sorry about that. And, it kind of sucks because I did that because I thought, well, I'll do a video tonight and then I'll kind of get back on schedule for last night basically, and then I'll have a video up for you guys today on time, and that didn't happen. Had some troubles getting that done. I was trying to make some prints last night, and you know, just printing troubles and stuff, and didn't even get sat down to draw, so didn't get that done, and didn't get a video shot. Now here I am shooting a video. What time is it? 2:30, which won't be up by 3:30, that's for sure. So yeah, I don't know. I don't think I'm even going to bother making this one a short one. I'm just going to go ahead and just make it a normal size video, and it can just go up when it goes up, probably about 2 in the morning or something. But, yeah, how's everybody doing out there? Everybody is ending their 100 Days of Comics, I notice. Peter Palmiotti, I already mentioned him in one of the other videos, and Scott Circland wrapped his up. I just watched his final video, and that's pretty cool. It's a lot of freaking work. It's yeah, comes a garbage truck, I think. It's a lot of work though to do that. I mean, just, you know, when I look at like kind of where I'm at with my videos and stuff, you know, it's just, yeah, just like where I'm at with like mine, I'm like in the 90s now, and it really makes you realize just how freaking many videos you know it takes to just do 100 videos. And it's I don't know, I think it's like all those guys have to be getting, you know, a lot of like a big benefit out of that, even if they're not getting a ton of hits, because just the fact that they're all getting comfortable talking on camera and stuff, that's got to benefit you in some way. It kind of made me think about, I think just because these guys are ending like my first videos and stuff like that, and you know, I remember like trying to make that first video, like the first one. If you go back and look, it's kind of just like a sketch card video that tells people what sketch cards are, and I draw like the Chewbacca sketch card that I usually use for my like profile photo, and just kind of showed my process back then. And that video was like a 2-week production, you know. Sorry, my chair's creaking everywhere, but yeah, it was like I took like, well, I don't know. I think I still filmed it all in one day, but it was just kind of like, because that's back when I used to do a card a day. And, I don't know. Actually, it might have actually been faster than that, because, it wasn't my first ever video. I did one other one, which isn't on YouTube, and I don't even know where, if I still have it on my computer somewhere. It would definitely be, like, somewhere stuffed in my backup hard drive or something. But it was like it was almost like a little book trailer kind of thing. For my comic book, Jack the Giant Killer, which I did kind of this adaptation of the fairy tale of Jack the Giant Killer, and redid it a bunch of times, and put it up for sale. Did it like a print-on-demand run, which I actually think I might have done that before Kablam was even around. I remember doing it through Lulu. I mean, this was like years ago, but I did it through Lulu, and the books cost like, you know, $8 a piece or some crazy thing for like a 24-page comic. And I took some to like a, you know, as like a free comic book store signing or something, and sold a couple there. But I think I was even selling it just like, you know, just like at a loss basically, because, you know, it cost so much to print. And yeah, it sure is different now, you know. I mean, back then, Lulu just wasn't really like a comic book publisher. I don't even think there was like a comic book option. But there was just kind of like a, you know, Saddle Stitch staple, you know, option on there. So, you know, if you did a 24 page anything and then you made the trim size right, you know. And I remember they messed up my, I messed it up, I guess you could say. But it had this kind of confusing way of uploading, and well, it wasn't that confusing, but I remember I had somebody helping me upload it at the time. I don't think I had the internet or something, you know, one of these kind of deals. And we uploaded it, and then somehow he managed to like upload like and missed a page or something like that. And so then we just uploaded the last page and didn't, you know, reorder it or something. And so, like, you know, it printed like the way it was ordered on the screen. And so one of the pages was like out of order in the book, which kind of sucked. And I don't know, you know, it was like back in the day when I just didn't, you know, I didn't know what I know now for sure. And just, you know, I didn't really have any idea of like where I could sell it beyond just like putting it on Lulu, like Lulu Store, which of course doesn't sell anything. Yeah, it just didn't really go anywhere. But, well, you know, it's just crazy. It's like things have changed so much, you know. And I wonder, I mean, I must have been painting at that time, I would think. But I bet I hadn't been painting long if I was. But yeah, it was a long time ago. But anyway, back to the video thing was I uploaded a like a video onto a site called was it Live Video? I think it's called Live Video, which I don't think it's there anymore. I went to Live Video a while ago. Just to see if I could find it. And I'm pretty sure the site is it's either gone or it's like changed to like a, you know, some other kind of like streaming site or something. And yeah, I don't know where that video is anymore, but that video took me quite a bit of time. But it was like a, like I said, it was kind of like a book trailer. So it was kind of like a collage, or what do you call that? Just kind of a, sort of like a slideshow, but, you know, with some movement and stuff. Kind of like when I do the Artcasters, you know, wrap-up video at the end of the month, and I show all the stuff, you know, so it kind of had the images moving. And then I cut together some music, like some music from a film, and then I think I had some stock music. And got the titles. It was like my first experience with Windows Movie Maker, and I remember somebody on the forums was talking about Windows Movie Maker crashing, and I remember when I was making that video, like, it would crash, like, you know, like, as you got towards the end of, like, doing the file, it would crash, like, over and over, if you move stuff around too fast, or if you, you know, if you did anything, like, too fast, it would just crash. So I would like just be constantly saving it, and it'd be kind of a fun video to find. As far as like the art in, I don't even know if I have any of the art. I do have this painting, which I've showed this on. This is just sitting in my room for some reason. It's usually in the living room, but it's like this oil painting, Jack the Giant Killer. There's the giant, there's Jack, and that's how long ago it was. It's a good example because I still have that piece. If I had painted that yesterday, that thing would probably be sold already. So, but that's the kind of book it was. And it was kind of a comic, but more like an illustrated book. And it was pretty decent. I did one version where I just kind of used the fairy tale, but then I don't know, later I read it and just didn't like the story, like the way it's wrote. It's wrote very kind of crudely, I think. And people, I remember, like, giving it to some people in my family and stuff, and they were like, oh, you know, like, the grammar in this is horrible and all this stuff, you know? And I was like, well, that's the way it is in the fairy tale, you know? I wouldn't want to change things. But then I ended up rewriting it, like, rewriting a version. And I liked it better. And it you know, and it kind of stretched my writing muscles, which it's like, that never happens anymore. So that was fun. But yeah, I should try to get that one up on CreateSpace at some point, but I don't know. Or not CreateSpace, but Amazon. I don't know, though. You know, going back and messing with, like, older work, it's kind of like I've got, like, so much work to do just to keep up with the art I'm producing now, getting it everywhere and out and, you know, like a possible book and all that kind of stuff, so I don't know if I even want to mess with it anymore. But I kind of birdwalked everywhere, but that was my first video I think I ever did. And on that one, I wasn't even on camera or anything. I was like completely scared to be on camera. And I remember sort of like when I was trying to come up with the idea of like how I would do it, trying to think of a way like where, and I was just thinking, it's like that might have actually been pre like webcam too and stuff. Like before I even had like a webcam, because I don't think I had any like footage of me drawing anything in there, and so like I just, you know, it's all just kind of moving images from the book, which, yeah, that's interesting. But yeah, I remember sort of like when I was thinking about how to do that, it just seemed like there's no way in heck I'm gonna get on camera and talk. And then I remember, like, when I did my sketch card video, later, that was, like, years later now, you know. This is clear down to where I'm actually selling sketch cards, and I want to, like, you know, promote my sketch cards, and I'm hearing that, you know, YouTube is, oh, I was going to say one other thing about YouTube and live stream at that time, or live video, is I'm pretty sure that maybe YouTube, it was either just starting, or it was like not there yet, because I remember looking around at like what my options were of like where I should load this thing, and I can't remember if I like looked at YouTube and thought that I didn't like YouTube or something, and then decided on live stream on live video or couldn't find YouTube because it just wasn't there. I don't know. That's a good question. Because, I mean, YouTube really isn't that old. I mean, I guess it kind of is, but I remember hearing about it, like, you know, like, for the first time, like, when I was painting on, like, some, like, you know, news show kind of thing, you know, like, some kind of news interview, and they were talking about YouTube, and I was like, what's that, you know? And I remember looking it up, like, you know, like, YouTube, like, with the letter U and then T-U-B instead of, like, Y-O-U-tube, so I couldn't find it right away. But anyway, like, however many years later that was, you know, 3-4 years probably, and I was doing that sketch card video, I remember just being like, you know, like I was just like, I have to force myself to get over it. I have to, like, be able to talk, you know, on camera if I'm going to do this. And just like being just like, oh, just terrified, you know, and just, you know, I probably wrote out what I had to say or something, or maybe, I don't know. I'm not good at, like, remembering stuff. I've done stuff, like, where I've tried to, like, do lines, not on my videos or stuff, but just other, you know, random videos with friends and stuff. And it's like, I have no memory for, like, memorizing lines and stuff, you know. I can't do that. I'm good at just talking off the cuff and stuff, but I am not good at, you know, I couldn't be like an actor, I don't think. And I get embarrassed in front of people, so I don't think I could, you know, pull it off. But anyway, like, yeah, my point was, it's just like, you know, when I think back on that, you know, first sketch card video, I mean, that was such a hurdle to get over, was just like talking on camera, you know. And that's something like all these 100 Days of Comics guys, you know, had a really good chance to kind of get over, you know. Which, I mean, maybe it's not a big deal for other people, but I've heard a few people say it, you know, here and there on YouTube and stuff, and maybe even in that group, kind of talking about how it's, you know, they're kind of camera shy or something, or they don't like their own voice, and, you know, it's like, I used to be that way, and God, it's like I can't even remember being that way now, you know? It's just like, I mean, it's gotten to the point where, I mean, for a while, like when I was doing my videos, I still was kind of like scared of like any kind of live kind of video, you know what I mean? Where like I felt like, oh, I might screw up and then I can't like take it out. So like when people would, you know, interview me on their podcast or something, it'd be like kind of stressful because I'd be like, oh, I don't want to say anything, you know? And then when I kind of started doing my own podcast, which was kind of short-lived, I don't know. I kind of got over that just because, you know, you got to get over it if you're going to, like, talk to people. And, I don't know. It's a good thing making videos. There's a lot of good... You get more comfortable in your own skin. And, I was thinking that with my art, too. Like, just like, I was kind of screwing around, the other night, you know, just sketching out, like, some random stuff, like a little dwarf and stuff, and, just for fun, and I thought, you know, it's just like, a lot of my fantasy art I don't have the confidence in that I have in my movie art, and it's kind of like, well, why is that? And, a lot of it's because, I want to measure this real quick so I get a line that's kind of straight around this piece. But I know a lot of it is just because I don't sell my fantasy stuff as much. I have sold a few pieces here lately, and I actually even have a fantasy art commission, which is coming up pretty soon. Just hang in there, dude. Those pieces are just harder to do than movie art. I have to, like, kind of, you know, figure out an idea and then, like, get together the reference and stuff. So that's why, you know, that one's kind of being delayed. It's just easier for me to grab a, you know, movie still and do something like this. And I also want to do something really cool, so. Anyway, hopefully that guy's listening. Let's see here. Now I've kind of lost my train of thought. What was I talking about? Oh, about the confidence thing. And that's what I was going to say was, you know, I have more confidence in the movie art because the movie art is what sold immediately back in the day up till now, you know. So I have, like, more confidence in selling that kind of thing. It doesn't matter so much if somebody don't like it, because it's like, that's not the point of why I'm doing it, you know. Let's see, actually I want to bring that in a little. And then when I do my initial sketch, I just go to town, and a lot of times I'm just not that straight. So, I kind of got to square it up at some point. See what the size. But anyway, yeah, like with the fantasy stuff, I think that was something, you know, I had online forever because I've always liked fantasy work and stuff. And then I never really had much success with that, but, you know, it's not a real fair comparison because I didn't know the stuff I know now. You know, it's like if I'd have known, like, the stuff I knew now, I mean, I would have never needed, like, painting career in the first place. I could have just started making money like I do now back then, and by now I'd probably, who knows, be retired or something. I need an eraser. I dropped my pencil. There it is. Lost all my erasers. Tristan's got a bad habit of taking off with them. I don't know why he likes them so much, but once he gets them, they end up who knows where, and I never do find them again. He used to bite the tips off of, like, these things. I'd have to keep these away from him, but, like, the little tiny erasers, he'd just pop it out, like, with his teeth for some reason. And it'd drive me crazy. Because then it makes it real sharp, too, you know, like, the ring is, like, real sharp, so he, like, falls and hits himself in the forehead or something. It makes a little poke on him, you know. But he's a little bit bigger than that now. But yeah, it's just, I think a lot of it is, it's like that selling your art is like, it's kind of cool because it gets you, it gives you that kind of, it like kind of verifies that. I think that's why I'm always complaining about critique and stuff now, because it's like, I mean, it has its place and everything, and I'm not against critique, but, you know, it's like when you're selling stuff, like, you know, like I do, it just doesn't matter. It's like, you know, it's just not the point, you know. That sounds horrible. I guess, you know, everybody always kind of like, you know, if anybody's like an artist and they say anything down about critique, it's just like, oh, you can't take it. But that's not really true. It's just so prevalent in art, you know. It's just so, like, I mean, you just, you know, so many artists just get stopped by it, you know. Not so much like, oh, I can't take critique, or even like, I can't handle the critique that people are giving me. Like, everybody's telling me I'm bad, so I must be bad, so I'm going to quit. Like, not even that, but they get so critical of their own art, which I've talked about this on the videos before, but they get so critical of their own work that they can't freaking, you know, do the project they want to do, you know. And I was so victim to that for so many years. And I think a lot of it was just, you know, for that same reason I just said, because it's like you don't sell anything. You know, I was like operating on faith in a way that like something was going to come along or some big break was going to come along and stuff. And it did in a way. It just came from a completely different direction than I expected, which is the internet came along, you know. And it gave me like the opportunity to take care of myself, you know, make my own breaks. But yeah, actually something has happened recently with at least one of my fantasy pieces. I don't know if it'll go on. We're kind of talking about some stuff, but a writer contacted me to use that. I did like a Frazetta kind of tribute piece with a guy from Fire and Ice with the wolf, you know, mask on. Maybe I'll flash it on the screen if I remember to get in there and edit this. And he wanted to use it for the cover of his book, and so we kind of talked about that, and that's probably going to happen, I would say. I mean, you know, it's more up to him, you know, when his book's going to come out and all that stuff, but that's going to work. And then, you know, he wants some more stuff, but I don't know, you know, the timeline or anything, but that would be kind of cool. Gives me a reason to kind of paint some more pieces like that. And, you know, of course it's like he's not going to... You know, the character's kind of... I mean, it looks kind of like that Frazetta character, but then it also could be something, you know, completely different. So I'll just have to change the name of it. But I don't know, his... from what I could see, like, you know, what I read of the little excerpt he sent and stuff, it was actually pretty cool. It sounds like something I'd like to read, so... whenever it comes out, I'll let you guys know. But yeah, it'd be neat to, you know, have a reason to do a little bit more fantasy stuff. And, I mean, one of the reasons also could be that I could just sell it, like, you know, because those other ones kind of sold on eBay anyway, so I could do a few more, just try to sell them. So... It's I don't know, it's a good thing though. there's just a lot. I mean, I've really changed my mindset a lot around about this kind of stuff. I don't know, like deadlines and things like that and pressure, you know, it's like I've always looked at it like it's such a negative thing, and anymore now I look at it like, no, it's a good thing because it drives you to get stuff done. It drives you to get work done and up and on to the next thing, you know. And that as artists is like our biggest obstacle in a way, just ourselves. And I don't know, just like with my own work, you know, when I was doing sketch cards, I had built like a pretty big site with a lot of images of all my work and a good portfolio. And, you know, once I went back to work and stopped doing that for money to make a living, and it was just, you know, I still did it a little bit for side money and stuff. You know, it took me like, you know, 3 years to even make like one gallery that I made in less than a year before, you know. And I've definitely noticed that now too. It's just like my site is rocking again because there's like all this new stuff and people are into the new stuff and they come to see what's next, you know. And, you know, the same with everything, even like eBay and stuff. It's pumping up again because people are interested in, you know, what's coming next. And the prints and everything, you know, the whole thing works better when you're just making more art. And it's just good to have a reason to make art, you know, even though, like, it's scary and stuff sometimes. It's also kind of exhilarating when you can make it work. I think the best example of that is like when I worked in comics for like, you know, whatever, a few years there, 3 years. And I suddenly, you know, I kind of went from, I don't know what I was when I did that, to like 26 or 7 or something, you know. And, you know, I was, you know, a lot different than I am now, but I still, like, I had a problem with finishing stuff. I was really into learning and technique, super critical of my work. I didn't like to sell anything because I was like, you know, I had this real like, oh, my work is precious kind of a thing. I don't want to, I don't want to give it away kind of thing, you know. And I went from that to suddenly being in like, you know, a deadline situation. With people counting on you, you know. A lot of people don't think about that when you're talking like comic book deadlines and stuff, that, you know, some of these guys that can't hit their deadlines, it screws over the other people that work on the book, you know. Beyond just getting your own self fired, if you're not delivering your pages to an inker in time that he can ink them, they split those pages off to other inkers to finish them, like on late books. And so, like, you know, that inker misses out on, you know, however many pages has to get split off to other people just because you can, you know, get your shit together and stuff. And that, you know, that kind of stuff, you know, weighed heavily on my mind. And I was good at hitting deadlines just because of that kind of thing, because I knew that, like, you know, other people are counting on you. You also had an editor breathing down your neck, and, you know, if you didn't deliver your pages that week, you know, they were calling you up. They were calling you up anyway, but, you know, they were calling you up wondering why. You know, it's just like, I couldn't get it together to where I could do good work in that situation. It was like, I could work, but it just wasn't, to me, like, my best work, and that was frustrating. But, you know, I don't know, I think if I had it to do over again, I would have approached it a lot different. And, I don't know, tried to do something within the time limit that I had. I tried to like my work within the time limit, which I couldn't really do. So it was like not looking you know, it just didn't look good by the time it got inked and colored and everything, or I don't know, maybe some of it did, but I just have a hard time, you know, looking back on that stuff. That's why none of that stuff's on my site or anything, but it still was like, it took a guy who was like, had a hard time finishing. I mean, I had my own comic book project going forever back then with some pages done and stuff, but, you know, I went from like that to suddenly like putting out monthly books, you know, and that was just because of a deadline. So, yeah. So, I don't know. I look at deadlines and stuff, and pressure is as a different kind of thing now. Something that actually makes you better, maybe. I don't know. That's one thing I think that's good, you know, bring it back around to the 100 Days of Comics guys, you know, it's like by doing that, it throws out some accountability. Like by saying that I'm going to do that, and then, you know, to the internet and the world, you know, whoever's watching, even if it's only, you know, your buddy, your internet buddies, they still kind of see, you know, see that you're not going to make it, or see that, you know, if you fail, then they see you fail. And, you know, it's just, it's added motivation to keep going, you know. I've been digging these drawing groups, too. I wonder how long I've been talking. I don't know, I don't have a timer going, but anyway, I've been doing these drawing groups. I missed a couple last week, but that was because last week was crazy, but, I was on there like this week. It's kind of a Skype drawing group with Peter and Kevin Cross is in there. This guy Odd, John Grisecki is usually in there. This guy Kenny Keene sometimes in there. A lot of the guys that actually hit the Artcasters chat and stuff. And we just sit around and draw on Skype and do our work. And, you know, it helps, you know, it's kind of like, it definitely gets extra hours in. A lot of times, like when I get on there, I'll get a piece done that I was like not even thinking that I was going to get done today, just because it's like I'm just sitting there talking and drawing, and the next thing I know, wow, this thing's done. So I actually love it. But it's also like it's good because of the, you know, it does kind of bring a little bit of accountability, you know. I don't know. I mean, I'm not really good at collaboration and stuff. Just because I think I've never really had anybody that I feel like kind of, I don't know, inks my stuff right or something. I don't know. It's just, I'm just not good at that, you know. I like to do my own work. But, I do like working with people for some reason. And actually, I really like working with people on the net, because it's like, if you get sick of them, you know, you just ignore them for a while. It's not like you're you know, in a studio lease with somebody you don't like, so it's kind of nice. But yeah, like this last, whatever it was, Tuesday, was just like this marathon show. I mean, we don't broadcast it, we just, you know, do it. And, but it was like, God, I think it was like 3+ hours just on there gabbing, and some of the people like on the East Coast were saying it was like 3 a.m. for them and stuff. So it's like, man, because like Peter sometimes will like call it at about, you know, 2 hours and be like, okay, let's wrap it up. But then like for some reason we just were going to town that night, and it's fun though. It's a lot of fun. Oh, Jeremy Burleigh was on there also. He's another YouTube guy. Hopefully I didn't forget anybody else, but I think, was it Paul Kijiji? He was on one of them, I'm pretty sure. Or maybe he was just on the Artcasters. Now all these shows are just kind of blurring together in this big, this big mess of shows. So. But anyway, I guess that's a pretty decent show for today. I go ahead and edit this, try to get it up today. hopefully I'll get this piece done. I don't know if I said what this is. This is another commission piece, but I did two for the guy who bought this one. Since they were just drawings, I thought instead of doing sketches that I have to redraw, basically redraw drawings, which I'm not into that, I just do two that I thought he would like, and then he just could pick which one he wants. And I figured I'd just put the other one up on eBay, because, you know, Yoda is like a good subject for eBay. So, thanks guys. Thanks for coming and hanging out and drawing with me. And I hope you guys are making good progress on your own stuff. And yeah, I don't know if you got a drawing group you got going. Who knows? Message me. Maybe I'll come hang out with you guys. So, anyway, talk to you later.